We do the extraction and measure the protease and antioxidant activity. We do the formulation because the goal of this study is immunomodulatory. So we do the research. We search the literature. The bromelain has immunomodulatory activity at the dose about 3,000 units. So when we do when we formulate about 4-5 milligram of granule, we want this granule contain about 3,000 units of crude bromelain. So from the previous study on previous we know the protease activity is 7.899. So to achieve the protease activity, we must use about 70%, 76% of crude bromelain as active constituent. Another, there is a 24% is excipient, like povidone as a binder, magnesium stearate as lubricant, and talc as a gradient, and lactose monohydrate as a diluent. After we do the formulation, we have a granule. We do the evolution of granule, based on the compendial method. We have moisture content about 4.1% and repose angle. So the excellent flow, bulk density and tap density is close enough. The value is close enough, mean distribution is for granule is good. Next, we do the Hausner ratio and carb compressibility index, because we want to make another formulation, not only granule. We want make a capsule or tablet if possible, due to the character of granule. And result of Hausner ratio and carb compressibility index. So fair flow character for the crude bromelain granule. So I think is we can make the granule to another preparation. Okay, after we make the granule and the granule is good enough, we do the another step is protease activity of the granule. With the same method like for crude bromelain, we'll see that the protease activity is a little bit lower than crude bromelain. So for there is a difference between granule and crude bromelain. There is a decreased protease activity. It's the same like antioxidant activity. There is a decreased antioxidant activity by 6.1%. So I think there is maybe we need another formulation to make sure that all crude bromelain can release from the formulation. Maybe there not only the evaluation so good result, but the activity must be good enough too, but we don't have time to make a reformulation for a better result. So for the conclusion, that crude bromelain can be formulated into granule with protease and antioxidant activity. Okay, I would like to thanks to Kemendikbud to financial support. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for the interesting presentation. Now we are open for discussion. Is there any question from the audience? Okay, maybe the first question will come from me. Okay, I would like to ask about the activity. Your main purpose is to get this protein domain with immunomodulatory activity. But you also mentioned about the protease activity and also antioxidant activity. I want to ask, what is the relationship between protease activity with this immunomodulatory activity?
Okay, thank you for the question. Immunomodulatory is close by to antioxidant, but not for and from my literature that I read, protease activity is contribute to immunomodulatory activity, but but I don't back the research about the granule yet. I made the research about the crude granule. Crude bromelain, not from the granule. So the next step, I will study about the what the function of the excipient is contribute to decrease activity or not. Maybe like the other result about the antioxidant and protease, there is a decrease, a little bit decrease about the formulation. So I think I need another research to make sure that our granule is good enough to give the immunomodulatory activity.
Okay, thank you for the answer. Now, is there any question from the audience? So maybe another question from me. You said that maybe you will try to make another formulation like a tablet or capsule. Why not the wet formulation like suspension?
Okay, because I think crude bromelain is a protein. So if we do the wet formulation like suspension, I think maybe the stability is lower than the dry solid formulation. I think like that. So I think the best formulation for protein preparation is solid preparation like capsule or tablet or couplet. I think like that.
Okay, thank you for the answer. So maybe another question from the audience. Okay, if there is no more questions, so we will close our first oral presentation. So thank you very much, Ibu Nyimekar Saptarini, for your presentation. Now we will move to the next presenter, Ibu Laila Susanti. Before we start the presentation, I would like to remind all of the participants here to fill the attendance in the link that have been posted in the chat room by Ibu Ida Ayumiati. So, and then for Ibu Nita, Ibu Nita will be our presenter for the first presenter, but we don't get your presentation file yet. But if, today you will use your own laptop, Ibu Nita. Still no response. Okay, maybe I will remind Ibu Nita later. Okay, now we will start our next presentation from the second presenter, Ibu Laila Susanti. Ibu Laila Susanti, the time is yours.
Okay, terima kasih, Miss. is my PPT has been yet? Miss?
Yeah, okay. We can see your slide very well.
Okay, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My title of my research is the effect of xylulose neclip cleanup telluride as a carrier of nonifruit Morindesi trifolia L as antifungal Malassezia globosa causes seborrheic dermatitis. Introduction. Seborrheic dermatitis skin disease is characterized by scaly skin, peeling, and inflammation. The disease is caused by fungi Malassezia sp, especially Malassezia furfur or Malassezia globosa, that interfere with the skin natural defense mechanism, causing inflammation occurs and then attacks the hair follicles and resulting in hair loss, and caused by alopecia. The seborrheic dermatitis treatment is usually in ketoconazole 2% with shampoo or cream, but the synthetic medicine is mostly side effect. So it must be, we have alternative medicine from herbal plants and zoolite from herbal plants. In this research, I want to combine the herbal plants from nonifruit and zoolite mineral. Because the nonifruit is contain ascorbin, scopolamine, alizarin, anthraquinone, and etc. And that's the zeolite, then, and this zeolite have a three-dimensional framework with multiple pores as a potential corrective compound from nonifruit. So it means that the zeolite is have a unique framework. It has with more multiple pores and cavity, so it means that the xylit is have a high absorption. So it is novelty with this research as anti alopecia with these two combined from natural product. It is the nonifruit and zeolite. In previous studies, nonifruit has a scalp dandruff hair, and then antifungal dandruff with fungi Pterosporum ovale, and then zeolite with species clinoptilolite. It is have anti-diabetic clinoptilolite zeolite with supplement in mice, and then the combine of nano nitrogen monoxide zeolite as an ointment for obese rats worn medicine. So this finding shows that this result is indicate that these two natural ingredients have the potential of to treat alopecia. The purpose of this study was to see the performance of zeolite with species clinoptilolite as a carrier of the nonifruit active compound against Malassezia globosa causes dermatitis seborrheic. Methods in this research is to produce noni extract by maceration ethanol, and then we have standardization of extract, specific and non-specific parameters, and then zeolite have activation at 200 Celsius, and then combining noni fruit extract with zeolite by stirring for 3 hours, and then antifungal activity test with the well method in PDL media against Malassezia globosa. Inhibition zone analysis in millimeter, and then analysis of the surface morphology of the sample by scanning electron microscopy or SEM. Results and discussion. Nonifruit extract. We start from 4.2 kilograms simplicia of noni produced 700 to 1,005 gram of extracts, and the yield was 17.28%. The parameter specific extract of noni was slightly bitter, dark brown, thick paste, taste less, light yellow powder, and slightly pineapple and natural odor of noni fruit, but not overpowering. And then the parameter non-specific extract of noni has water content, 9.95%, total ash content 0.41%, acid insoluble ash content 0.30%, drying shrinkage 1.73%, density 0.88%, 86 gram per mili, ethanol soluble extra content 3.58, and water soluble extra content is 0.324%. And then the zeolite we have to analyze with XRF, X-ray fluorescence, to found is there any heavy metals or not. So the result is no heavy metal is the heavy metal, and mostly of zeolite mostly contain of aluminium, silicon, kalium, calcium, ferrum, and zinc. So it is conclude that zeolite is food grade, not have heavy metals like plumbum, argentum, or aurum. Results of antifungal activity. After we have antifungal activity with PDA media against Malassezia globosa, we have results in the table. We see that the table in the left, it is a concentration, variation concentration, and then this is in the second column, it is the inhibition zone with millimeter, only extract nonifruit. And then the fourth column, we have the zone inhibition, extract and zeolite after combining. So it is we'll see that in control positive it is ketoconazole. We have the inhibitory response is strong, and then in control negative, in SMC, inhibitory response none. We have a 0 millimeter, and then control zeolite, only zeolite, against Malassezia globosa, we have inhibitory response none, and then 0 millimeter. And then starting with 5% until 25%, we have inhibitory zone with difference between extract and zeolite. From the table above, it can be seen that there is a differences in the inhibition zone between nonifruit extract without zeolite and nonifruit extract without and nonifruit extract plus zeolite. The differences starts from a concentration of 10% to 25%. Okay, we'll see in 10% inhibitory response with only extract is weak, but inhibitory response with extract and zeolite is medium. In 25% is similar, but we have a different millimeter. So the result of statistical test showed that the concentration of 15% was the differentiating concentration, which show the effect of zeolite in the extract sample. And then I use same analysis to morphology surface. It is the three picture. The one picture is only nonifruit extract. The second is zeolite, and the three is nonifruit extract plus zeolite. There is a three differences in the surface morphology. So it can be illustrated that the surface of the noni extract with the picture one is tends to be smooth and what is it like? Like seperti awan apa ya kemudian, and then the surface of the zeolite in the picture two shows the porous crystal form. This is a porous of crystal, porous and cavity. And then after combining, there were more pores and cavities, which show good absorption power. We'll see that it is so more pores and cavity. So it means that the picture tree, it has more absorption power. So it can be conclude that the compound of noni fruit is still in the zeolite. So from this research, I want to have conclusion that zeolite acts as a carrier for the active ingredient of noni fruit in inhibiting the fungus Malassezia globosa. Thank you.
So thank you very much. Yeah, thank you very much for the presentation. So it's exactly 10 minutes. So now we are open for any question from the audience. Yeah, Ibu Erin, ask your question.
Okay, thank you. I would like to ask Ibu Laila, what is the benefit of pores and cavity in the combination of noni fruit and zeolite?
The benefit ya Bu ya.
Yes.
Cavity and pores is most, what is it? It described that the bacteria or fungi is trapped on the pores or cavity. So it means that the bacteria or fungus is more trapped when it traps. So it can be concluded that the zone inhibition is higher than without zeolite. Or we have explained that the cell. The cell of fungus or bacteria is, what is it? Ketarik itu, is trapped in the pores or cavity.
Okay, not for next your formulation maybe.
Yeah, my formulation. For the next project formulation, I want to make preparation of serum combining to natural product noni fruit and zeolite.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, okay, miss.
Okay, thank you for the question. So we still have time for another question from the audience. So maybe the next question is from me. So as you said from Ibu Nyimekar's question, from your answer, that after mixed with zeolite, the antifungal activity of this extract should be increased. So is there any data that show that the activity of the extract only without zeolite is actually lower than the combination of extract and zeolite?
Another data, miss?
Yeah.
You mean another data? In the previous study, I have to research extract Brotowali with zeolite against Staphylococcus aureus and Pseudomonas aeruginosa. It is to prove the zeolite have the good performance to increase the zone inhibition in my previous research. Miss Mute. I'm sorry, mute.
Sorry, yeah. How about the data of the extract only? How about the inhibition zone?
In Staphylococcus aureus, the extract, only extract, is lower than the combining of zeolite and extract Brotowali. I already published in 2017 about that, and it is proof that zeolite is a good performance to combining with herbal to against bacteria, and then I want to against fungus, especially Malassezia globosa causes dermatitis seborrheic. Seborrheic dermatitis.
Okay, thank you for the answer. I think we still have time for one other question. So no more questions. So let's close this presentation. Thank you very much, Mrs. Laila Susanti, for your
presentation
and our discussion. So let's move to next presenter, Ibu Julia.
Okay. Yes.
So the next presenter will be presentation from Ibu Julia Susanto. Ibu, the time is yours.
I'm sorry, I can share my PowerPoint.
Really?
Can I need help to I can sell the yes.
Okay, so our
okay thank you. Good day, thank you for the opportunity. I am Juliet. I'm from Department of Pharmacy, Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Science, Tadulako University. Today, I would like to present about our research by title "Effect of Hibiscus Ratensis Leaf Extract and Active Fraction on GLUT4 Expression in Gastrocnemius Muscle of Diabetic Rat Induced by High Fat and Fructose Diet." The background problem of this research is about diabetes mellitus. The next. As we know that diabetes mellitus is a problem that faced by world because the increase of incidence, high mortality and morbidity. Also, it needs high cost for treatment and prevention. Type 2 diabetes mellitus is a condition in which insulin unable bind to receptor on the insulin-dependent cells of the liver, muscle, and adipose. The placement of glucose transporter 4 affect blood glucose level in patients with type 2 diabetes mellitus. The next. Traditional herbs have an important role in primary health care of individuals in many development countries, for example in Indonesia. Indonesia is a country that is rich in natural sources, has the opportunity to maximize the utilization and benefit of its natural product. These natural products are considered to have potential in the underlying the development of diabetes and its complication, and to be able to cure the metabolic abnormalities using a variety of mechanisms. Hibiscus SSL is one of the traditional medicine plan. Ethnobotanical and ethnopharmacology studies have highlighted their use in traditional medicine in many countries, such as hypertension, urethritis and venereal disease, malaria, wound, abscess, gonorrhea, stomach pain, cough, diabetes, and hepatitis. Our previous research has shown the extract, ethyl acetate fraction, and water fraction of Hibiscus ratensis leaves have a hypoglycemic effect on the oral glucose tolerance test in normal mice, and the ethanol extract and active fraction show the ability to inhibit DPP4 activity. The next. So, this study aim to determine the effect of extract and active fraction of Hibiscus ratensis leaves on GLUT4 expression in gastrocnemius muscle of insulin resistant diabetic rat induced by high fat and fructose diet. And the result of this study may provide to invent and develop new drug research. The new drug research is expected to able to improve the GLUT4 function, so it can maintain long-term glucose control that caused by high fat intake and insulin resistance. The next. This is the research methodology. The first, we collection of Hibiscus ratensis leaves from Alindao village in central Sulawesi, and then maceration use 96% ethanol to obtain ethanol extract. And then fractionated using the liquid-liquid partition to obtain N-hexane fraction, ethyl acetate fraction, and water fraction. Ethanol extract, ethyl acetate fraction, and water fraction we use to observe anti-diabetic activity in animal model of type 2 diabetes mellitus by high fat and fructose diet induction. The next, experimental for animal model, we started male and divide two into group, normal diet and induced by high fat and fructose diet for 60 days and given treatment for 21 days. And the parameter was observed is fasting blood glucose level, and the end of experiment, the rat were sacrificed to take the gastrocnemius muscle and immunohistochemistry analysis for GLUT4 transporter. The next. The result of this study show that high fat and fructose diet induction can cause increase for fasting blood glucose level 2 times greater than the healthy control. And the treatment, the extract and water fraction can have ability to reduce fasting blood glucose level at 7, 14, and 21 days. And the decrease of fasting blood glucose level is significantly different from negative control. The area under curve calculation is performed to determine the effectiveness of reducing fasting blood glucose level. And the treatment group show the lower of area under curve and significantly different from negative control. And the next. The result of effect of high fat and fructose diet on the GLUT4 expression in gastrocnemius muscle. So the ethanol extract and ethyl fraction of Hibiscus ratensis leaves have the potential to increase GLUT4 expression in gastrocnemius muscle that is significantly different than the negative control. So the conclusion for this study is the next. So that Hibiscus ratensis leaves to have potentially beneficial effect on the treatment of type 2 diabetes mellitus with the probable mechanism of targeting GLUT4 glucose transporter, including increasing GLUT4 translocation and expression. Okay, thank you for the attention.
Thank you very much, Ibu Juliet, for the presentation. So now we are open for the question. Is there any question from the audience? Ibu Nimekar.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Intan, okay, I would like to ask Ms. Juliet, how high fat and glucose diet can make a diabetic mice? How the mechanism?
Okay, thank you for the question. High fat and fructose diet induction can cause obesity to the animal, and the obesity is one of the risk factor for decreased sensitivity in insulin.
Okay, how long the induction for the high fat and fructose diet?
60 days.
60 days.
Okay.
60
days.
Wow. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for the question. So, the next question from the audience. So maybe the next question is for me, Ibu Yuyet. So your research clearly show that the metabolic extract and the active fraction give the activity for the diabetes. What is because the activity come from the ethyl acetate extract and also the water extract, so we can conclude that this active compound, maybe a polar compound or semi-polar compound. Is there any report about what kind of metabolite that responsible for this activity from this hibiscus?
Okay, thank you for the question. The compound from ethyl acetate fraction is semipolar. Our research show the compound is flavonoid, example camphorol, quercetin, and morin.
So most of the active metabolite should be come from the flavonoid group.
Yes. Our research isolate the ethyl acetate fraction, and we find camphorol is one of the compound potential to contribute the anti-diabetic activity.
Okay, thank you very much. We still have time for another one question from the audience. Still any question? So if no question, we move to another next presentation. So thank you very much, Ibu Juliet, for your interesting presentation. So now we will move to next presentation from Ibu Nita Artiningsih. Ibu Nita Artiningsih, I hope your connection is better now.
Maybe permit me to off the video.
Mm-hmm.
I will share the presentation.
Okay.
Can you see my slide?
Yes, we can see your slide very well.
Okay. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Okay. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you for the moderator and organizing committee that pleasing me to share my research. My preliminary research about ethanolic and methanolic tepak darah Cataranthus roseus LG Dawn leaves extract activity as Streptococcus pyogenes antibacterial. And the content in this presentation is about the reasons why I chose this research topic and why this research is important. Then the purpose of doing the research, the methods used in the study, the result of the research, and the conclusion. And the topic of this research is about hemolytic anemia. Hemolytic anemia caused by streptolysin from Streptococcus pyogenes bacteria. We know that Streptococcus pyogenes can cause global burden disease that related to rheumatic fever and rheumatic heart disease in developing countries in the world. And hemolytic anemia is caused by Streptolysin O and Streptolysin S that excretion from the bacteria. And hemolytic anemia often seems in lupus and be part of autoimmune disease that such as autoimmune anemia, hemolytic autoimmune, and always along with the autoantibody reactions because of the superantigen from the Streptococcus pyogenes bacteria. And the therapy commonly used in patients with a clinical manifestation of hemolytic anemia is usually give corticosteroid, but we know that the action of corticosteroid directly affects the genome of host, and there is a risk of mutation in genes, maybe a phosphorylation of corticosteroid in genes can make the genes overexpression or silencing. In addition, if used in the long term, it can cause kidney problems, overdoses, if it is not consumed according to doctor's prescription, and will be cross reaction with other drugs. And antibiotics are the most appropriate therapy to eliminate Streptococcus pyogenes bacteria at present, but in long term use certainly has side effects. And the real problem is the resistance bacteria, because based on various studies found a small number of Streptococcus pyogenes strains which has experienced resistance to penicillin. So it looks necessary for herbal antibacterial that can eliminate Streptococcus pyogenes without causing malignant side effects for both patients and the bacteria. Tapak dara leaves extract known to have 70 type of alkaloids and other bioactive compounds, and if we consume in long term in experiments on mice, that doesn't cause damage to the kidney. And the leaves extract of Cataranthus roseus has antibacterial activity of Staphylococcus aureus and Pseudomonas aeruginosa. And the purpose of this research is to find the salt and concentration of tapak dara leaves extract that having better antibacterial activity, and to know the compound and modeling visualization of bioactive compound interaction using the bioinformatics. And this is methods that I used for the sample preparation. I used old leaves, Cataranthus roseus, because there are four more secondary metabolites, and the bacteria I used from the Faculty of Medicine, Universitas Indonesia, which came from the throat sweat, that gold standard for diagnostic patient with rheumatic fever indication. And then the leaves will extraction with methanol and ethanolic solvent. And the concentration is 96%. And then if we have thick extract, we we continue with petrochemical and organoleptic assays, and then we use this diffusion antimicrobial activity and MIC assays to find the diameter diametry inhibitory, and then we'll the data will analyzes by ANOVA, and we use a visualization modeling by informatics by software such as PIRX and BioFia Discovery Studio, and we use study literature from NCBI, and this is the results from sample preparation. The dysplasia of tapak darah leaf powder is carried out by characterizing the moisture content and ash content, and we can see that moisture content and ash content is at the standard set by the Ministry of Health, so the quality of the powder tapak darah dysplasia is very good. And then for the extract, filtered color is dark green, and the rendement is so high. And then we used to analyze moisture content average and ash content average to see the water content that that entering the extract. And this is a phytochemical assays in tapak darah leaves extracts, both of ethanolic and methanolic extract. The alkaloid, flavonoid, saponin, steroid, and tannin is present. And alkaloids and flavonoids, we know that the compound is very beneficial to antibacterial and antioxidant. And this is a result for this diffusion antimicrobial activity for ethanolic extract. In the ethanol extract, we can see that the concentration of the extract required is very high, has a correlation with the activity of flavonoid compounds, which can form complex bonds with extracellular proteins and bacterial cell walls. So that damage to bacterial cell walls doesn't occur directly in causing cell death. So it tends to be weak in killing bacteria. And this is a result for methanolic extract. The methanol extract showed a decrease in bacterial growth if the concentration of the methanol extract increases, because the maybe tannin and alkaloid compounds will increase the ability to kill the bacteria if the concentration of extract increases. This is based on a molecular visualization of the receptor and ligand interaction that carried out on various virulence factors that I use DNAs, hydrolase, lysate, exotoxin, M-protein, and streptolysin O, that virulence factors in Streptococcus pyogenes bacteria. It can be known that predicted interaction between the streptolysin O receptor and alkaloid class compound that will have a hydrogen bond with streptolysin or streptococcus pyogenes receptor. And I found that flavonoid, that alstonin, synergically with the alkaloids.
You only have 1 minute left.
Okay, thank you. And this is the alkaloid groups, maybe a few alkaloid groups that makes a complex that hydrogen bond with a hydrolase streptococcus pyogenes receptor. But in cantharanthin and a few alkaloids that are not found, the interaction between C5A50Ds, DNA, cytotoxin, and protein analyzed with bioactive compounds in Cataractus roseus still unclear to known by conducted comparisons with various literatures on NCBI. And we know that ethanolic extract and methanolic extract have to inhibit the growth of Streptococcus pyogenes bacteria, and the optimum concentration between two extracts is good for methanol extract. And phytochemical tests result with bioinformatics can describe the interaction with streptolysin O and hydrolase receptors based the binding of hydrogen. This suggestion in my research. And thank you for your attention. Maybe.
Okay, thank you very much for the presentation, Ibu Nita Tiningsi. Now we are open for the question from the audience. Is there any question?
I would like to ask.
Okay, Ibu Nyimekar, please.
Okay, thank you. I would like to ask about the what the parameter why you choose the there is a lot of receptor. What the reason you choose that receptor?
Maybe can I can hear your voice very well. I'm so sorry.
Okay. From your slides, I see there is a lot of receptor. Why you choose a lot of receptor? What the difference between one receptor from another receptor?
I'm used the very maybe many receptors for this Streptococcus pyogenes, because the Streptococcus pyogenes has many armamentum that make the bacteria resistant from too many antibiotics, and the bacteria has to increase excretion excrete so many enzyme, and I use the protein such enzyme to be the receptor of the okay, to bind with my natural compounds.
Okay. Have you identification that the compound that you reacted with the receptor is in your extract? Have you identified?
I have to identify, but I can share in this presentation because the time is limit.
Okay, but are you sure that your extract is contain the compound? Okay, thank you
very much.
Thank you very much. So we still have time for another one question. Okay, so maybe one short question from me. Ibu Nita, why do you try to extract by two kind of organic solvent with methanol and ethanol? Because as I know that methanol and ethanol has the same polarity, so maybe the kind of metabolite that extracted in the organic solvent will be similar.
In my research, I had to try to extract the tapak dara leaves with ethyl acid, but I can't found the organic compounds because the organic compounds in the tapak dara leaves extract very high in polar organic compound. So I used the organic maybe a polar solvent, and I think that methanol can attracts too many polar compound from the tapak dara leaves extract rather than the ethanolic extract.
Okay, thank you. So thank you very much, Ibu Nita Tiningsih, for the presentation and discussion. Now we will move to the last presenter, Ibu Putranti Adirestuti. So Ibu Putranti Adirestuti will give the presentation. The slide will be presented by our company. Okay. So Ibu Putranti, the time is yours.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you for the time. Ibu Nyimekar, Ibu Intan, sorry for the trouble and thank you very much for the help. My name is Putranti from Pharmacy Faculty, Unjani at Cimahi. This is my campus and this is my team, Putranti, Anggi Gulimular, Anissa Hana, Rifan Fajar, We research about ANCAP or MALT MRM, MALT red MALT red MALT is R. Okay, I'm sorry, my English is so bad. Yeah. As introduction, next please. As introduction, I will invite you to be aware of the consumption of foods that contain dyes. The results of the BPOM Indonesia investigation show that until now, there are still found food containing hazardous chemicals. For example, in Yogyakarta in 2019, found red crackers or kerupuk merah containing rhodamin B. In 2015 in Jakarta, found puddings containing titan yellow. Both of these chemicals are not included in food additive. Both of chemicals is dangerous for us. The effects can cause cancer. This situation is proof that until now, there are still many foods that contain dangerous chemicals. What the solution? I think by increasing information about the dangers of chemicals in food and getting used natural food additives will make people more concerned about the safety of themselves and their families. One alternative is RMR or red malt rice or ANCAP as a natural coloring. Next, please. This is the methodology of our research. The research stages are follows. The first is mass RMR to a size of 30 mass. For the second, extraction in water with microwave at 400 watts. For 30, 40, 60, 120, and 180 seconds. The third stage is color stability test at room temperature for 35 days by measuring of the pigment absorption value at 488.5 nanometers. Absorption value data is used to measure the pigment color. The fourth stage is the effective extraction time in water is used. So the result of the water extract stability test were used for extraction in ethanol. The extraction in ethanol used 400 watts and the time is 60, 120 and 180 seconds. The fifth stage is a freeze drying process of water extract and ethanol extract of red pigment in RMR. The goal is to facilitate microbiological testing, ease of storage and extend shelf life. And the sixth stage is testing of microbiological activity using agar diffusion and microdilution method using Escherichia coli, Staphylococcus aureus, Aspergillus flavus, and Candida albicans. Those microorganism is contaminate food contaminating microorganism. next, please. The result is the first result is absorption light values of red pigment. The microwave can extract pigments from RMR in a short time. The best results are obtained from the extraction of 180 seconds with a power of 400 watts, indicated by a large absorption value. This slide showed us its extraction time and 180 showed that the red pigment is attractive color, red color, and this is the best color from extract. The next, please. The second result is pigment color value of RMR. The value of the pigment is 29.15 CFU per gram, obtained for extraction at 400 watts or 85 Celsius degree for 180 seconds. This is the best color. And the color reduced for the 35 days to 23.9 CFU per gram on day 35. Next, please. The third result is the stability red pigment of RMR. In 35 days, decrease in the light absorption value occurred in the product extracted was 17.81%. In this condition, the red pigment of RMR was the most stable during storage 35. Next, please. The fourth result is microbiological potency test. The sample is used to microbiological potency test used against four microorganisms. E. coli, S. aureus, A. flavus, and Candida albicans. And RMR extraction for 180 seconds resulted in a pigment extract that inhibited bacteria with a diameter of 12.37 millimeter for E. coli, and 12.82 millimeter for SR use. The extract but did not inhibit A flavus and C albicans. Next, please. The fifth results showed that minimum inhibiting concentration, all aqueous extracts showed none against the microbial growth of the say red pigment of RMR freeze dried from ethanol extract showed inhibiting E. coli and S. aureus growth, but no effect on Aspergillus flavus and Candida albicans. inhibiting diameter or MIC for E. coli and S. aureus were 20% width per volume, with diameters is 9.62 millimeters and 9.72 millimeters respectively. By using microdilution method, 500,000 microgram per milliliter of pigment extract can kill E. coli and S. aureus, but has no effect on Aspergillus flavus and Candida albicans. Next, please. The conclusion, the first conclusion is the MAA or microwave assisted extraction method could extract the red pigment of RMR in a very short time with good and attractive color. The extraction at 400 watts or 85 Celsius degrees for 180 seconds produce a dark red pigment in ethanol extract. Looks more attractive than water extract with a color value was 29.15 CFU per gram. The second is red pigment of RMR extracted by 180 seconds is considered the most stable, stored at room temperature for 35 days. Its absorption decrease is 17.81%. And the third is 20% weight per volume of red pigment could inhibit E. coli and S. aureus bacteria with inhibiting diameter of 9.62 millimeters and 9.76 millimeters, but did not inhibit E. flavus and C. albicans. The extra concentration of 500,000 microgram per milliliter can kill E. coli and S. aureus, but didn't kill A. flavus and C. albicans. Next, please. Special thanks for Research and Community Service Unit or LPPM Anjali. Then this is the reference. Thank you for attention.
Thank you very much for the presentation, Ibu Putranti. Next, we are open for the discussion. Is there any question from the audience? Ya, Ibu Nyemekar, please.
Okay, thank you, Ibu Intan. Bu Putranti, I would like to ask you, do you store the pigment on the liquid or solid?
I use the extract for stored at temperature, room temperature for 35 days.
Okay, so 35 days in maybe thick extract or liquid extract?
Liquid extract.
Okay, maybe you can make it concentrate to make a better stability. Mm-hmm. Maybe, I don't think so. I think the result is good enough, but because you store in liquid extract, maybe there is a lot of water, maybe. So the quality is or stability is lower. Okay. Next question. I would like to ask
why only effective to E. coli and what's more, Staphylococcus aureus?
Yes, Escherichia coli and Staphylococcus aureus.
Why only effective into microbe?
I think the bacteria consists as cell walls. Yeah, cell walls is containing a protein, so the protein is easy for destructive. I'm sorry, my English is so bad. Yeah. The extract containing of flavonoid. See, so the flavonoid is more effective to destroy protein than chemical content to Aspergillus niger or Candida albicans.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. We still have time for another one question. Okay, maybe one short question from me to Ibu Putranti. So this red color produced by the fungi that used to ferment for fermentation of the rice, is it correct? Mm-hmm. Okay, so what is the chemical content of this red pigment? You mentioned just now that maybe kind of flavonoid. What kind of flavonoid? Because this color is so bright and so red.
Yes, thank you. I use we use brass angkat for the research, not use the Monascus purpureus because the pigment for difficult to extract, yeah, from Monascus. So we use brass angkat or red mold rice for the research. Yes, in research in telusur pustaka, ya, telusur pustaka, red angkat contain yang red pigment is rubropunctamin and I'm sorry, I forget. There are so many color from the extract, and the red color is rubropunctamin. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the answer.
I'm sorry for my presentation. My English is not good.
So thank you very much, Ibu Putranti. So we have reached to the end of this oral presentation session. I do hope that this seminar and discussion give us more knowledge and insights about research in our own expertise or in pharmaceutical science and technology in general. So thank you very much for your attention and for your presentation and fruitful discussion. Please don't forget to fill the attendance in the link in the chat room. The link is written in the chat room. So let's meet again tomorrow for the second day of the this webinar in Zoom, starting at 8:30 in the morning. We still have international speaker from Australia and Philippines, and also from Indonesia, and followed by the next oral presentation afterwards. So again, I say thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Mrs. Intan.
Okay.
Thank you. You are welcome. Terima kasih, Ibu-Ibu.
Okay. Request to leave.
Mm-hmm.